Okay, let's get started. Who wants to lead us in a song? Nobody? Okay, Father, we thank you for your grace, your goodness, your love, your blessings. We thank you, God, for hearing our promise and all of the provisions you have made for us. We thank you that you have blessed us with all spiritual blessings, heavenly places in Christ. So we thank you that beginning the good work within us, you who have begun the good work. You shall continue. Father, we thank you that our eyes are upon you. Hallelujah. You ever live it to make intercession for us. You are touched with the fulfillment of our infirmities. That you love us as you love Jesus. Father, we thank you, God, for all of the promises that you made to us. We thank you, God, that you call us into fellowship with your Son, Jesus. And he was made sin for us so that we might live unto righteousness, Father. And we thank you, Father, for the plan, the redemption of our spirit, soul, and body. We thank you, God, because you paid the price. Suffered and died to bring us to God. So, Father, we thank you for reconciling us. We were alienated and enemies in our minds by our wicked words. You called us out of darkness to this marvelous light. Yes, you delivered us from the power of darkness. Yes, translated us into the kingdom of your Son. Thank you for all. Every good and every perfect gift to all from above, from the Father of lights, who has ruled the light of the shepherd. Thank you, Father, for your grace tonight. Your grace is sufficient. Your age, God, calls whatever measure of grace we need to abound toward us, so we will have sufficiency in everything. Father, your grace is sufficient.
Yes.
Your grace is sufficient. Hallelujah. Thank you today for all of the promises in you are yes. Amen. All of the promises. There hasn't failed one word of all of your promises. Yes. Your promises are sure.
Right.
Every seed of every generation. We praise the glory tonight in Jesus' name. The name that will conquer hell, Satan, death, and strength. Name that's been highly exalted, lifted above every name. May in the name of Jesus, every knee must bow, every tongue confess. Jesus is Lord. Jesus, you are Lord. We give you praise and the glory tonight. Hey, bless you. Amen. He shall. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Everybody say in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Same page. Same page. Same page. Same page. Everybody got this book, right? Okay. All right. We don't need y'all. How many want a higher quality of faith?
Amen.
Let's go.
Okay, we have a section in this book here called Building the Highest Type of Faith, Declaring and Acknowledging God's Word. And start on page 88, the integrity of the Word. What does the integrity of the Word mean?
whichever word means what.
Means what? All right, it's true, but it's faith, genuine, that's the word of God. All right, do you think we need to convince ourselves that the word is, the word has integrity? But sometimes what God says doesn't register, it doesn't resound. And sometimes we don't always respond to it like we should, because sometimes people say, well, if I do what God says, then I'll be hanging in the thin air. I'm not sure whether I'm on solid ground all the time. You know, sometimes when you're trying to act on the word of God, you do sometimes feel like that you might be on shaky soil. We're going to sing this song, Christ, a solid rock I stand, all other what ground. But I think it's good to build into your spirit that the word is the word of God, and the word will never return. That is an area that we have to consistently focus on. The word of God being the real word of God. If it's dependable, if it's real, God's word don't return void. And we can always rely on it. You can go back and do research, and you'll find out that out of all of these thousands and thousands of years where man has been in existence, God's word has never proven to be unreliable. Isn't that good to know?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. The Bible says, faithful is he that calls us, and faithful is he that will do it. Amen. So we want to begin to build the word of God into our spirits. You know, I was in a conversation with the pastor today, and we were talking about the challenge that we have with people actually affirming the word, people embracing the word and having the word of God in their mouths day and night. Did Joshua say something about that?
Yes.
Don't let the word of God what?
Depart.
Okay. What does it say? Don't let the word of God what?
Depart
out of your mouth. What does that mean? That means that what?
To speak it.
And David said, I will meditate, I'll talk of his doings all day. And that's what David said back in the Old Testament. Remember, David is the one that started the institution of the tabernacle of David, where they praised God 24 hours a day. It wasn't a place where they offered sacrifices like the tabernacle of Moses. But it was a tabernacle where they came and assembled, and they had about, let me see, three shifts of priests that praised God around the clock. All day. And whenever they got up to do the word, they didn't have Bibles like we have Bibles today. They would have to read the Bible or hear the Bible read from somebody, they would just kind of repeat. And sometimes they would be standing up for 8 hours straight. So they would stand up for hours after hours repeating the word of God. They would go back and rehearse all of the history of what God had done for them throughout the generations. And that was the thing that enabled them to stay in faith and also to have a vibrant form of worship. They were able to go up into seven levels of praise. Start with singing, and then they would, you know, begin to go higher, begin to praise God, get happy, shout, dance, and then sometimes they would just fall out in the spirit, gifts and things would operate, God was showing things. And finally, they would break out in spontaneous singing, which would be the seventh level of praise, which is the highest form, but they will go through all of these different levels of praise during their time of worship. So that was the format, you know, of God's people, how they kept the word of God and kept the praises of God consistently in their mouths. And that's the challenge we have today in the church. We don't have that many people. The reason why we have people are so weak and they're not strong as they should, because many times they don't obey God in the area of constantly talking of his works and of his doings, the things that God has done for us, the realities that are based on Christ's finished work. Many times we don't talk of these things, and that's one of the reasons why I put this in this book. I tried to extract all of the, as many of the promises and provisions that Christ atoned for. I tried to put them in different categories so that we would be inspired and motivated to agree with God in our confessions, in our daily talk, our daily walk. It means so much. And as I was talking to this minister, I was just telling them how difficult it is to get saints to do what God plainly tells them to do. And the Bible says that we are to affirm. Now, let me just say this, that how many heard about the doctrine of inclusion? The doctrine of inclusion?
Yes.
Okay. The doctrine of inclusion basically says that Christ has atoned, he's died, he's made with all these provisions, so all of us are saved, regardless of how we live or how we respond. So he died that everybody might be saved, so nobody's going to hell, because everybody's saved. Okay, here's the thing that you need to know as well, that will give you a lot more clarification about that particular doctrine. Now, Christ did pay the price. He did become our substitute. And by him becoming our substitute, that was the way that we were reconciled back to God. We were brought back to God through Christ's substitutionary death and work on the cross. We were brought back, made it possible.
Yeah.
So yes. The Bible states that Christ has suffered for us, and he has made provisions for the whole world to be saved. So all of the world actually is saved legally. That means the price for the salvation of every person on the face of the earth has been paid for in full by who?
Christ.
By Jesus Christ. So, everybody is saved. I mean, if you look at it from that standpoint, because Jesus has what? Paid the price. And his redemption has been what? Perfectly perfected. Ain't nothing left remaining to be done. And he's at the right hand of God, what? Sit down. And that, his work is what? It's all over. And it's kind of up to us to what? To receive what he has what? Done. Is that right? Now, here's the next step. Now, when Christ finished paying the price for our redemption, and we've gone over that he was born out of death. He was born out of spiritual death. Born out of spiritual death means that Christ actually became sin for us. At that point, when God placed his sins, our sins, on Christ, that's the point. That's the day Christ died. He died spiritually. And if it hadn't been for that, Christ would never have died physically, because you can't die physically if you are not dead spiritually. Because we were made to what? Live forever. We were actually made to live forever. Y'all know that, right?
Yeah.
Until Adam sinned, man would not have died physically. He would not have died. Okay, so Jesus would not have died. They could have shot him, they could have cut his throat, They could have pushed him over the cliff. He still wouldn't have died because he was not mortal until sin was laid on him. Okay? Everybody agree? Everybody got that?
Yeah, yeah.
The moment Jesus became sin, then he became mortal. And therefore, 3 hours later, he died. And his spirit and his soul had to atone for our sins. It was not just a physical atonement. It was also a spiritual atonement. Because when your spirit and soul comes out of your body, it goes somewhere at death. When you die physically, your spirit and soul comes out. And that place that it goes depends on your decisions, the decision that you have made in regard to accepting Christ or not. Okay, so Jesus had to atone for our sins by suffering. Now, somebody said, how could a spirit and soul do anything to affect salvation on our part? Well, your spirit and soul is the main part of you. If you could see in the spirit world and see how... Anybody ever seen a spirit?
A ghost?
You're a ghost? You used to call them haints.
Haints? Ghosts?
Anybody ever seen a spirit?
Yeah.
Somebody got born with a veil on your eyes or whatever.
Yeah,
veil
over you.
But the spirit world is actually more real than the physical world. And if you could see your spirit... I would say, John, your spirit will look just like John. I mean, like, people in hell know each other. They know. People in heaven know each other. Your spirit and soul doesn't change from the image, the physical image that you have. And somebody used to say, when people die, when Jesus comes back, how old will I be? So, and will I look like me? Okay, suppose I'm 85 years old. Well, when Jesus comes back and changes from mortal to immortality, probably you're not going to look beyond 33.
Why?
Because Jesus said that we are going to be made like unto him, the likeness of his image. That was the age. That's the prime age. And that's the age that we will appear at that particular point.
Praise God.
So that, ain't that good news?
Amen.
All your teeth will be replaced. That's what the change is all about. That's what mortality been swallowed up in victory. I mean, so you'll be perfect if you are, on the right side of your faith, if you are not, then I guess if your teeth been knocked out, beat up, fallen out, then you won't get no replacements. That's where I. That's where
I no replacement.
So I'm glad. I'm glad it's like that. How many glads are like that? But what I was saying, I'm trying to get to, is that Jesus has actually finished. The work of redemption, and when he was raised again from the dead, when Jesus was raised again from the dead, that was the day that all of us were born again spiritually. All of us were born again in the mind of God. It doesn't mean that everybody, the doctrine of inclusion says that everybody, since everybody's been born again, everybody's been saved through Christ's death. Then I don't care how I live, I don't care whether I receive Christ or not, everybody just won't go be saved. Because Jesus has atoned for the sins of the entire world. But it is true that Jesus, those 14 indictments that God, that was hanging over the head of every human being before Jesus actually fulfilled his redemptive work, those 14 indictments, none right, none good, all have done this, all have gone out of the way, no fear of God before that. That's Romans 3. That's the first thing we started on in the salvation book. Now remember that. Those 14 indictments hanging over the heads of every human being. But all of that, you see, Jesus has what? He has paid the price, and he has what released us from all of those indictments. When you speak from a legal aspect, he has released us. So he doesn't impute sin against the believer, and all of the sins of the world have been imputed. He doesn't impute sin. What I mean, the sins of the entire human race have been imputed, were imputed unto them before Jesus actually. In other words, they were held accountable for all of their sins until Jesus actually removed them. See, the sins of the Old Testament saints, y'all know the Old Testament saints that had faith in the blood and the coming of Jesus Christ, by them offering up those sacrifices, which was a type of the blood of Jesus, they were able to be, their sins were able to be what? Covered. They weren't remitted. They were only what? Covered or swept under the rug. So those sins had to be what? Dealt with. God wasn't going to let nobody off until what? Jesus came and settled the score. And when Jesus settled the score, all of the charges were dropped. I mean, for everybody. So legally, everybody is saved, the doctrine of inclusion. That's true. But you are not saved in reality until you what? Accept Jesus Christ as your what? Lord and Savior. You still go to hell if you don't accept him. So the doctrine of inclusion just doesn't go what? They don't go far enough. They said, well, he atoned for the sins of the world. He no longer imputes sins against the world. He ain't holding nobody accountable for sin no more. Well, legally, he has what? Removed them and dropped all of what? The charges of mankind. So everybody can be saved now. And he charges us with the what? The ministry of reconciliation. I mean, we got to what? Go out there and what? Tell them about Jesus before they can actually what? In reality, be what? Be saved and have all of their sins remitted. Yes. Amen. So now, the point I'm making is that the work was done through Christ is finished. All of us are saved. All of us are delivered. All of us are blessed. The charges, all of the sin charges have been dropped legally. But in order for us to receive our own what? Remission of sins, we have to what? Acknowledge Jesus Christ as our what? Lord and Savior. Otherwise, you still be in sin. But God is not holding the world accountable for all of the sins that he has what atoned for. In other words, it's possible for you to what? To step up and accept Jesus Christ and receive eternal life. Okay, now, here's another point that you want to consider. And the reason why I'm going around about, and I'm trying to tell you about this book here, these confessions and things that pertains to all of these new creation realities. Okay, now, we didn't get saved either, although Jesus had what? Done all of this? I mean, y'all know Psalms 88 is a horror story. Isaiah 53 is a horror story. All of the things that Jesus went through in order what? To reconcile us to himself. He went through a whole lot. When you meditate that and go through that and really dig it out and try to get a good understanding of it, you will see that Jesus suffered like no other person have ever suffered. It was just horrible, horrible, the things that he went through. Okay, now, although he did all of that, nobody is going to be saved in reality until they what? They receive the finished work of Christ. They got to what? Stand up? And they got to what? Confess him as what? Lord and Savior. The gospel has to be preached, and they have to what? Respond to the gospel. And when they believe the gospel, the scripture says the gospel is the power of God unto what? Salvation unto everybody that what? Believes. Everybody can say amen?
Amen.
Okay, now, you have to believe the gospel, and believing the gospel means that you got to hear the story of what Christ has done for you. You got to hear the gospel. See, the gospel is the good news. It's the power of God. The Bible says it's the power of God and the wisdom of God. And if you notice, that all of the apostles that preached, all of the records that we have of them, whenever they got ready to do business, they always did it with the word. They would always go back and talk about what? Christ is what? Dead, his crucifixion, and what he went through, and the things that pertain to the 3 days and three nights that Christ suffered and to get us back to God. Okay, now to tell the truth, you can't get saved without what? Believing in your heart and confessing with your mouth. Right? You can't get saved. Is that right? But with the heart, man, what? Believing unto righteousness, but with the mouth, what? Confession is made unto salvation. So you can't get saved until you what? You hear the gospel, you got to hear the good news, you got to know what God is offering before you can what? Receive what he has. So you got to hear the gospel, and the gospel is the thing that builds what? Belief in you. You can believe, because whenever you get enough sufficient, whenever you are sufficiently enlightened, then that's the ground, that's the thing that enables you to believe. So believing is derived from an accumulation of knowledge. Okay, but when you act on what you believe, that is what we call faith, acting on what you believe. Everybody agree? Yeah. You act on what you believe. In other words, the first action that you take whenever you when you have believed something, the first action, if you want results God's way, the first action, you have to affirm what you are what? Believing. You have to say it. That's the first action you take. There are a whole lot of other actions that what? That's, you know, that comes afterwards, but the one that establishes the word of God in your heart is what? The word coming out of what? Your mouth. The word coming out of your mouth. Okay, if you can't get saved without confessing the word, believing it in your heart and confessing with your mouth, what about all of the other promises? What about all of the other promises and provisions that God has made for us through his redemptive work? How do you get them? Do they come automatically? We got to get this straight now, because next week we start consecration. And the only way I feel that we can actually get this straight and get established in this to get results that we need, I think that we're going to have sessions where we will come and spend quality time affirming the word. Affirming the word. You know, in order to go through all of these confessions, because we're supposed to confess. I mean, to tell the truth, whether y'all will accept this or not, David said, I will speak, I will talk, I will meditate all day. Joshua said the same thing, you know, to meditate with all day. David said, I will meditate. Let me get this, all of this in your book, I want you, if you got this little book here, this yellow book, if you got it, I'm going to show you, amen, praise God, how we can have a breakthrough of a consecration that we never had before. And everybody that's not working, raise your hand. Not during the day.
Not on the 9 to 5
job. 9 to 5 job, and you can spare 2 or 3 hours. Okay. All right, okay. So I got something in mind. Okay, but I'm going to show you something here. Go back to the pages. You know, when I said page 88, that doesn't mean that you ignore all of the pages that lead up to 88. Some people want you just like a wheelbarrow. It won't go no further than they'll push. And actually, the first 47 pages are the ones that I started with. We didn't even have 47 after 47 in this book. For years, I mean, nobody had the book but me, probably, and 2 or 3 more. I'm going to show you the page with is my Speak Out God's Word. Okay, speaking. What's page 22? Page 22. So you don't know what you have here. This is this is probably
a lot of key scriptures that are designed to build you up. Because, see, some of y'all read the Bible through, but after you read the Bible through all the year, if you could just extract out those verses, if you just get them all together, my Lord, you would have a what? You would have a, my Lord, I mean, it would be awesome for you to be able to go through the Bible and every scripture that really registers, that really stands out, that really expresses a resounds in your spirit or really gets you, you know, if you could just deal with that scripture for a while. If you had all of them grouped together, where you can go back and just recapture the main stuff that really registered, wouldn't that be good? Yeah. How many? Maybe I need to work on something like that. How many? How many know that would be good if you could just go back and just try to get those scriptures that really deals with the key provisions of God's word that He has given us? All right. How many would like to have something like that?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm glad that you have agreed that this is something that you're talking. This is basically what this is.
Yeah.
I've read the Bible through, and there are certain things, but the things that actually are probably most effective in building the highest type of faith in your life are going to be those scriptures that that's centered around the redemption. Now, even in the Old Testament, I mean, I was reading this week. I've been reading about the atonements that were offered up for healing. Job was healed by an atonement. You know, all of that chaos and confusion that he had with his friends, and all of the deterioration of his flesh, and all of the ill health. We say he went from 212 down to 67 pounds. Soul was driven off everywhere. I mean, he was a sight to see. I mean, everybody was running away from him after he had become so popular, the richest man of the East. And he was a man that what feared God and eschewed evil. But Job went down to nothing. And so in the final analysis, God turned his captivity. But God told him to do certain things. He had to offer what? A sacrifice. He made an atonement. And then he had to what? Repent of his sins. And then he had to what? Pray for his friends. And the Bible says God what? Turned the captivity of Job. And the Bible says his flesh became pure than the flesh of a child. How could that kind of result be receive just from basically offering up an atonement? See, the atonement was a type of who? Christ. Right? It was a type of Christ. So any scripture that points to Christ, which is the, you know, all of these types were pointing to the antitype, which is the what? The reality of the thing the type is pointing to. So everything that focused on the atonement, centered around the atonement, it's packed with power. Something miraculous, what happened? The brazen serpent. How many remember that? When the children of Israel were ordered to what? To kill those what? Those sacrifices and what? Eat their flesh and place the blood above of what? The door of their households. Amen. And when they did that, what happened? The death angel passed over. What else happened? They were what? Released from what? Bondage. Amen. And everybody that was sick, miraculously, what? Were healed. See, everything that points to the atonement that centered around those 3 days and three nights, that Christ, everything that points to that, is what? Is powerful. So if the types were that powerful, Job could be healed by what? Offering up a what? Well, offering up a ransom. And if the children of Israel could be what? Healed and saved by what? Offering up the sacrifices and eating the flesh of the what? The sacrifices. Amen. And you can go all through the scripture and you'll find all of these atonement types. All of them are pointing to who? So the real thing is what? The 3 days and three nights that Jesus actually what? Atoned. Y'all got me? So if you can get a revelation of the 3 days and three nights, what happened? Amen. Get a revelation that you'll never be the same. You will never be the Paul says the gospel of is the power of God unto what?
Salvation.
And that's all the apostles what? Centered their message around. Paul said, I'm determined not to know anything among you except for what? Jesus Christ and him what? Crucified. And Isaiah 53 goes behind the scene and shows you not only the physical sufferings of Christ, but the what? Spiritual sufferings of Christ. Psalms 88. Amen. It focused strictly on the what? The spiritual sufferings of Christ. And once you get a revelation of that, you will never be the same. Paul said, I count all but loss for the what? Excellency of the knowledge of Christ. Jesus, my Lord, for him I count all things but what? Dung, that I might what? Win Christ, that I might be found in him. He talked about the fellowship of his sufferings, and he talked about the knowledge of what? The power of his what? Resurrection. Okay. All right. So those are the things that everything that we believe are centered around. Okay. And you want to know, you want to understand. You know, I just keep rehearsing this because the first part of Christ's substitutionary work, I would say, represents what Christ actually did in terms of becoming identified with humanity. He had to become sin. So he had to be, he had to relinquish his place as God, right? And come in the likeness of human flesh. Everybody understand that? So he never would have become a mediator unless he had identified with humanity. He had to come from heaven, and he had to come in the form of a what? Servant. Everybody agree that?
Yeah.
Everybody agree?
Amen.
He had to become a what? Servant. Otherwise, he wouldn't be able to what? Relate to what? To man and bring man and what? God together. He came to bring us back to God because actually no way for man to come into God's presence except through the divine appointed ways of the Old Testament. That's the high priest and the sacrificial system, right? Visions, dreams, or angelic visitations. Those were the only ways that men could really actually approach God. And the greatest need that mankind had was that he had to have what? He had to become righteous before he could what? Actually get connected or come back into fellowship. He had to become righteous. In order to become righteous, he had to have what? Eternal life. Everybody say eternal life.
Eternal life.
Okay, that was the greatest need that man had when he sinned, to be what? The nature of God, the life of God, amen, in his heart. I mean, the return of the life of God, that was the greatest need that man had. And secondly, we know that he had to have he had to become what? Righteous in order to be, you know, called back into fellowship. And that depended on eternal life. And then the third greatest need that mankind had was a mediator. Now, who was the mediator? To bring them back to God.
Jesus.
Although Jesus came in the form of a servant, and he qualified in terms of becoming humanity, he was humanity and God. He was 100% what? Man. And he was 100% what? God. So he was capable of bringing the two back together. But the problem was that man was spiritually dead. He couldn't connect man back to God when man was what? Spiritually dead. Is that right? Was he able to reconcile them while he was in the earth before he had consummated his will?
No.
He couldn't bring them together. Because what? Man was spiritually dead. So something had to be done by, about the what? The sin issue. That's the reason why he had to become what? Sin. See, although he qualified, he was humanity, so he, that put him on a level where he could identify with all of the things that we are, you know, are dealing with here. So that was a perfect setup, but yet he was spiritually what? Dead. But he became our what? He became sin for us, who what? Knew no sin, that we might be made what? The righteousness of God. Okay, now, the fact that when Christ had actually went through the atonement and, after, you know, suffered physically and suffered spiritually, which one do y'all think was more probably was the most difficult for them to do? The physical or the spiritual?
Spiritual.
Okay, the spiritual. Okay, why was the spiritual more excruciating, more difficult, more agonizing?
Spiritual death.
All right, that was the first time since he had been God, been Christ, been separated from his Father. And we know that separation that he walked out was what? Beneath the earth. It was a spirit world that required him to partake of in order for him to settle the issue and for God to drop the charges. So he suffered spiritually.
Yeah, like when did he recognize he was spiritually dead?
Mm-hmm.
When did that hit him? I'm spiritually dead.
You're asking a question?
Yeah, you know, separated from the Father.
Yeah, he was separated. He recognized it because when he said, my God, why has thou forsaken me? And then Psalms 88 has a vivid description of that period of time that he was separated from his Father. And what he was saying, mm-hmm. how he was responding, mm-hmm. how he was dealing with it.
And you know, even with us, often our emotional hurts go deeper than the physical.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can get a spanking or whatever. You can remember when you were a kid. As soon as that sting was gone, hey, you're okay. But if you're hurt emotionally, sometimes that lasts. It goes deep.
Soulish.
Yeah, soulish, mental, and spiritual. So don't tell me that you can't be tormented spiritually or emotionally or mentally. You can be tormented. And that's what Jesus was agonizing with. And the little stuff that we call agonizing and tormenting, that ain't nothing compared to what Jesus, because he was agonizing for the sins of the entire human race. He had a whole jillions of people. Jillions of people that he was hurting. His pain, you know, emanated from. So, when the story of what he went through makes you cry and weep and, you know, and really begin to regroup and say, well, I mean, Jesus went through all of this. My Lord, my husband. And he went through all of this, and I can't even bring myself to affirm any of these good things he did for me. I can't say it. And we need to understand that even when Jesus was made alive, okay, what does that mean, when Jesus was made alive? That was the day that we were made alive. Anybody can explain that? When Jesus was made alive, after he had finished all that God required of him, made alive. In other words, he received eternal life. He became born out of death. And that was the day the Bible says when we were dead in trespasses and sin, Christ what? He quickened us together with him, right? He quickened us together. That was the day Christ was born, and that was the day we were born. Legally. Right? Y'all know what I'm saying? Legally? Legally, that's the day we were born. All right. We were born out of the pains of death that Christ suffered.
What?
That travail. Okay.
Yeah, the day that he was made alive.
Mm-hmm.
That's the day that the penalty had been paid in full.
Hey, the penalty had been paid. That's the day God dropped the charges. After the charges were dropped, then it was possible on legal grounds for eternal life to become given to everybody. Well, it was given legally then, everybody. I mean, God dropped the charges against everybody, but nobody can receive a benefit until they what? Actually what? Act on what he's done legally.
Yeah, and they're not alive until they act.
Right. They're not alive until they act. Everybody got that? All right, so that's the first stage of Christ's substitutionary work, from the time that he left heaven to become man, is that right? Until the time that he became alive. That's the first, as I call that the greatest achievement of all times. Anybody agree with me? The greatest what? Achievement of what? All time. And we wonder why the name of Jesus is so powerful. Well, you can write that down in your notes. Of his achievement. We got two more aspects of his redemption that we got to bring on the picture. Okay, but I think the most crucial aspect of Christ's redemption for us, I believe it was even from him becoming what? Man. Becoming human. I mean, becoming man, right? Becoming man, in other words, he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. And that, you know, that was humiliating enough to come down as God, you know, and all of those rights and privileges and prerogatives and the power, you know, the omnipotence, the omniscience, and everything that made God God. Jesus was that person. He was equal to God, 100% God. But he came down and he relinquished all of those rights and privileges and came down and functioned for 33 years as a what? As a man. And when he got ready to what? To do works or to speak the word or to perform anything, he was completely dependent upon who? God. Everybody follow me? So that was, okay, from his relinquishing of his rights and privileges to the point that he was made alive. You know, this day I have begotten thee. That was the word. Find it in the Bible, Hebrews 1. This day have I begotten thee. This day, amen, y'all understand what I'm saying? This day have I what?
Raised thee alive.
Y'all have ever heard that before?
Yeah.
So I'm saying, well, that was just when Jesus was born. That wasn't when he was born. All right. Anybody can find that? Maybe I'll just give you let me see who's outstanding in here. Find it real quick. This day, have I begotten thee? This day. It's in the Bible. All right, so I'm all right, there's Hebrews 1 something and Acts 13:33, I believe. It's in two passages.
Acts 13:33,
what does that say?
God had fulfilled the same unto us, their children, and that he had raised up Jesus again,
mm-hmm.
as it is also written in the second psalm. So it's in the second psalm also.
Right.
My son, this day have I begotten thee.
All right, this day have I begotten thee.
Hebrews 1:5.
Mm-hmm. All right, everybody said that. This day have I what?
This day have I begotten thee.
All right, that was the very day that we were begotten. when you're speaking like that, y'all are what? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I was born, I was begotten. In other words, amen. We were, when he was born again, that meant that what? We were born again. That was our birth. Amen. Is that enough to praise God about? But
yes.
Anytime people don't praise God because they don't know what it's talking about. I don't know what that means. Everybody, Jesus was a baby. He was coming into the world, he was a baby. That's what it means. That's not what it means. That means Jesus had what? Had finished all of his what? Sufferings. All of his agonies, all of his pains, and all that he went through. And God said, well, amen, I'm pleased. Amen. Please the Lord to bruise him and to take him through all of that, because he was accomplishing something far better than the sacrifice that he was making. Okay. Now, I call that the greatest achievement of all time.
Amen.
But when Jesus was born out of death, then he was able to what? Defeat Satan.
Yes.
To take back the what? Dominion that Satan had what? Taken from who? Adam.
Yes.
And we call that the greatest conquest in history.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Well, the Bible says he spoiled what? Powers. And that's what the Bible says. We wrestle not with what? Flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, what? Powers and what? Rulers of what? Darkness of this world. That's what we wrestle against. But, amen, it's good news to know that Jesus has already what? Conquered them.
Yes.
It's done. It's done.
Yes, 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 yes.
Amen. In the mind of God, they are already what? Conquered. Does that mean that everybody has conquered them in reality?
No, not until they act.
Not until they what? Not until they act. I guess my out time must be running out. Kids now in here. All right. Amen. All right. So, what I was getting at is how Jesus got his name. See, our walk with God, our salvation is just going to be so shallow. And that's one of the reasons why people don't want to praise God that much. They don't see nothing that have happened. I mean, but the greatest, y'all remember that the greatest achievement of what? All times took place. The second thing, the greatest what? Conquest. See, Jesus wouldn't have been able to what? To regain the authority of the dominion. And that was huge because the dominion included what? Everything that pertained to life. I mean, everything initially God had created, he had created for what? Man to what? To be partakers of. It was like paradise. The Garden of Eden, God blessed us with everything that pertained unto life and godliness initially through Adam. How many can say amen?
Amen.
But that was restored through Christ because what? Jesus what? He was able to retrieve it as a man. Even that don't hold no significance to you. He was able to retrieve it as a what? Man.
Thank you, Lord.
Not as God. It was already his as what? God. Because he created everything, right? But he had to what? Retrieve it as a what? Man, so that he would be able to what? To turn it back.
Yes, ooh, yes,
glory.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
See what?
I said,
it wasn't a God that lost it. It was man who lost it.
That's right. That's right. Man, God didn't lose it. Man is the one that what? Because Jesus was operating in that authority, right?
So he had to come back and...
Well, to tell the truth, a lot of the old patriarchs and prophets operated to a great extent in that authority, right? On the basis, although they had a limited righteousness, they were just servants. They didn't have a full package. But we have an unlimited righteousness, right? And also, we have what? And we are sons. They weren't sons, they were servants. It seemed like to me, praise God, we are living on the brighter side of
the world. Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
All right, well, The reason why Jesus' name is so powerful is his achievement. Everybody say achievement.
It's achievement.
Is what? Conquest, his victory over what? Satan, sin, death, and the grave.
Yes.
And then he retrieved and took back everything that the devil had what? Stolen from us. So that was by inheritance. He said that he received a name because he inherited a name. He inherited a name. So the inheritance have birthright privileges because he was the first one that was born out of what? Death. Well, that might be a little too over y'all heads. birthright, because see, when he was born out of death, that gave him what? Birthright, what? Privileges. Birthright. Everybody said birthright. The firstborn, amen, was always the one that was a ruler. The firstborn was the one that was the priest of the what? Family?
Yes.
Amen. The firstborn was always the one that inherited more than everybody else.
Amen. That's
right. But can I interject?
All right.
This is great. and correct me if I'm wrong, but Satan didn't steal anything. Adam gave it to him.
Yeah.
And it's like, who was the brother that gave up his birthright?
Mm-hmm.
You know, oh man, what a mistake.
Yeah.
So now, Adam, you messed up. You, what God created, gave to you, gave to Satan. And God says, I can't have that. And I got to figure out a way how to get it back to my man.
That's the reason why he had to go through all those legal actions.
Yes.
Amen. That was a roundabout way.
Yeah.
But he had to what? Do it in a legal way and be just to what? Himself?
Mm-hmm.
Just to what? A man? He had to be just even to Slewfoot. All right, time is out. All right, now, what I'm getting back to is that these have to be confessed. In order for your salvation to kick in, you have to what? You have to confess it, you have to believe it in your heart and confess it with your mouth. All right? All of these rights and privileges have to be received the same way. Because you got saved and born again and filled with the Holy Ghost and talking in tongues? These new realities won't just kick in automatically. You got to what? Speak them. You got to do the same thing. So absolutely every provision that you can get your hands on that you can affirm and confess, you need it. Don't feel like you don't need this. All right, so all of these aspects of Christ's redemption that pertains to new creation realities that we are privy to, these things need to be confessed. We're going to have a consecration coming up, and I'm going to see how many are going to be available during the day. I want to have a team that all we would do is come out and confess these things, and maybe for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours straight, just go down the whole thing, start with 88 and going down to 100 pages. All right, and then after we do that for a while, then pray in the Spirit to see how easy it's going to be. You ain't going to want to stop praying in the Spirit. And then we can sing songs in conjunction with all of these realities too. Amen. And then we can intercede for a whole lot of other things too. So those that are available during the day, during our consecration, and we're going to start next week, and we're going to have several weeks that we're going to be doing this. And I just want to see a complete transformation on the part of this church in terms of getting, okay, the reason why, today I was reading the reason why, okay, Sister Jill, okay, the children.
Yeah, they
got
to
go ahead and
the homework to get it
read.
Okay.
Small children. Okay, why, okay, I'll take this up a second, all right?
Yeah, that'll be good. Okay. I want to give the announcement.
Okay.
Saturday prayer.
Okay. Okay. Oh, yeah. Y'all try to go through as many of these things as you can. 88 on.
Uh-huh.
And it's Sunday, a Saturday when you come for whole hours with an empty head and empty heart. that's not going to be good. Praying and striving and trying to holler and squeal to try to get some life in you. You have your own life.
What are you doing?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm
going to speak.
You're doing everything on camera.
Yeah. I can go stand in front of
you.
Thank you.